So basically, we have seen the basic commands in Linux yesterday, and I have given one exercise to install Vagrant, Oracle VirtualBox, and Git on your machine. Anybody tried, or any issues you're facing? I have asked you to download and install Vagrant, Oracle VirtualBox, and Git. Anybody tried?
I have downloaded and installed Oracle VirtualBox, downloaded both Vagrant and Git, but I didn't install them.
Okay, yeah, fine. Anybody else? I mean, anybody facing issue basically? So it's just like .exe files, just download from internet and based on your operating system and try to install them. Okay, at the end of the class, towards the end of the class, we'll see how to get a VM up and running with these tools. Okay, so one more thing you have to do is you have to enable the virtualization on the laptop. There is something called VTX we have to enable. Just Google Git download, you'll be able to get it. Something like download Git. So Git downloads. So this will be your download. Windows and then 64-bit. So it is asking to save. So based on your operating system, just select this. The same way Vagrant, in the same way Oracle VirtualBox. And you may have to reboot your machine once you install all these things. And one prerequisite is we have to enable virtualization. So basically what are we trying to do here is create a virtual machine on top of the, we'll come to that, how do we get a VM up and running. Okay, so how do we enable virtualization on top of the laptop, right? So we have to enable the virtualization. How do we enable? So close all your application, reboot your machine. While rebooting, yes, while rebooting the machine, so it depends on the operating system, depends on the hardware as well. So just press escape continuously till you go into BIOS menu, basic input output system menu, and there is an option called virtualization technology, VTX. So this will be enabled or disabled. There will be two options. By default it is disabled, so you just have to enter. It will give options, enable or disable. You have to enable it. Enable and save. I think first save it will be something, you press F10 and exit. Then it will come up with virtualization enabled. Then you can try creating a VM. We'll see how to create that, but just try these steps. First download all this software, then enable the virtualization. If you find some difficulty, just Google how to enable the virtualization. They'll give clearly with the screenshots, like reboot the machine, press escape, then how does the screen looks like, then how do, so basically it's like there will be a graphical user interface and there will be a BIOS menu. You just have to traverse through it, and then there is something called virtualization. There you have to enable, disable. There are two options: enable it and save and continue. That's all. Okay, we'll see how to create a VM after some time, but now we'll continue with the basic commands. So yesterday we have seen some of the commands, right? So how do we list the files? What is a directory? So ls is the command to list, right? And ls-lrt to list, long list, based on the time they are modified. Rm is the command to remove a file, right? Rmdir is to remove a directory. This is, directory has to be empty to delete it. So to forcibly, recursively, to delete everything, rm minus rf. Okay, if you want to delete recursively, right? So what else you have seen? Mkdir to create a directory. Is it okay if I continue with the basic commands, or you already know everything? Anybody, any non-Linux users here?
It's myself. No idea about Linux.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Because if everybody knows everything, there is no point in continuing. So I just wanted to check. So mkdir is to create a directory, and then cd is to change the directory. If you want to go to some other directory from your directory, cd we go to change directory, then cd dot dot is to go one level up. Okay, and let us say you are in directory A, and I have then after some time I changed my directory to F. Let us say I am in directory A. Let me see, 1 minute. Okay, so I am in directory A. Present working directory shows as I am in A. Then I did executed this command, which is cd bcdf. So I went to a directory called F. Present working directory will show my current path as abcdf. Now I want to go back to my previous directory. Cd dot 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 dot. This will go 3 levels up, right? So if I'm in F, I'll go to D, C, B. Or we can also do one more thing. What is that? Cd hyphen. This will go back to previous directory. Cd dot dot is one level up, right? This is one level up. Cd dot dot slash dot dot is two level up. Cd minus is to go back to the previous directory. You are in one directory and you change it to some other directory, and cd hyphen will take back to the previous directory. So this dot dot indicates one level up. Another dot dot, two level up. Another dot dot, three level up. Like that, we can go to any directory if you are in some subdirectory. Okay. So we will also see, I said ls-lrt will actually give 9 columns. Right? We would have seen in ls-lrt output, it has given 9 columns. Let me log into a machine. Don't worry about all these things. You'll learn all these things, how to log into your machine, how to execute the commands and vagrant and all. So for now, just focus on the basic commands, ls-lrt, right? So there are only two files, and let us say if I give ls-lrt slash, I'll get all the directories in the slash. So slash is like a highest point in the Linux, right? If you see, there are 9 columns in this directory. Okay, so what are these and what is this and what is this? So you know, these are the file names. File names are the directory names, right? These are the files are the directories. And what is this and what is this? So this D indicates that it's a directory. So the starting letter in the ls-lrt output, D indicates it's a directory. Okay, hyphen indicates it's a file. So in a directory, there can be several files or several directories, right? So generally, D indicates it's a directory. Hyphen indicates it's a file. Let us say I'll just create a file, touch slash file. This will create a dummy file. If I do away again, ls-lrt slash, so there is a file created in the end. If you see, this is the one which we created just now. And what is the first character? Hyphen indicates that it's a file. So D indicates it's a directory. So L indicates it's a soft link, that we'll see later. But for now, D is directory, hyphen is the file, right? Then there are something called permissions, RWX, RWX, RWX. Okay, we'll see them what are the permissions. Then you have something called to. Okay, this to indicates that number of files in the directory. Okay, so first thing is directory or file or symbolic link, the first character. Second character is permissions of the file. It will be read, write or execute. Okay, then we have user ID, then we have group ID. This is user ID, this is group ID, and this is the size of the file or the directory, right? And then the file, the date in which is modified or last modified or created, then the file name. So these are the permissions of a these are the columns of LSFNLRT output. There are 9 columns and these are the different attributes, right? So first is either directory or file, then the permissions, then number of files in the directory, then user ID, group ID, then the date, timestamp, size and the timestamp, then the file name, right? So we'll go through each of it. What is each of that and why it is useful, right? So when I say Linux server and it is a some applications are running on the server and the server is in the data center and data center is a remote location and multiple people will be working on that machine, right? So when I say, let us say there are 3 teams in the organization: development team, test team, production team, right? And let us say there are 2 users in each team, dev1, dev2. These are the users who log into the Linux machine every day and they work. In the same way, there are test1 and test2 users. In the same way, there are prod1 and prod2 users, right? So this is possible. There is a machine in the organization and there are people working on it and there are different teams. And one is development team, another is test team, or let us just, for example, take build team. The users are build1 and build2, right? So when I log in as dev1, I log into my home directory called /home/dev1, right? If I say pwd, if I enter pwd on the machine, I'll be inside /home/dev1, right? So I'll have my own files. Let us say I created my files in the same directory, file1, file2, file3. Right. So when I create these files will have permissions, right? So read permission means anybody can open and read it, right? Write permission means somebody can edit my file. They can just open it and write something to it, right? And then we have something called execute permission. What is execute permission? So if it is a shell script or Perl script or Python script, anybody can execute it. Right, if we have the execute permission, then only execute it. So as a developer, I just want, let us say, only my team members to have read, write and execute permission. I don't want anybody else to have write permission or execute permission. They only should be able to read it, right? See, there are 3 teams: dev, test, build, 4 teams, production. And I logged in as dev1 to my machine and I'm inside /home/dev1, and I have some files, file1, file2, file3, and I want to define permissions. I want to restrict the users from accessing it, right? So I don't want anybody else. I don't want anybody else from test team to write into my file, edit my files, or I don't want anybody from build and production team to edit my file. So they should be able to read it, but they should not be able to write it, right? So how do we set the permissions? Right, so this read permission is called W, so execute permission is called X. So that is what you see here: read, write, execute, read, no write, execute, read, no write, execute, right? So what are these? So if you see, So basically, I am from development team, so I want all my team members to access this file, write into this file, execute this file, right? So dev2, if he logs into this machine, and he can work on dev1 files. Owner is dev1, but dev2 can still read the file, write the file, execute the file, because this guy has given permissions to his own team members, right? Whereas if I log in as test1 or build1 or prod1, I cannot write into this file or I cannot execute this file, but I can still read this file because dev1 has restricted the permissions in that way. So how do we do that? So he has given permissions like this. So generally there are three kinds of permissions: read permission, write permission, execute permission. And there are three kinds of users. What are they? Current user, group to which he belongs to, others. These are the three different people, there are different groups available in Linux. So in this case, who is the current user? Dev1. I logged in as dev1, so I am the current user. Who is the group? The group which he belongs to. So he belongs to a group called dev, right? And others. So all others, like people from test, build and production, they all come under this group, right? So I restrict permissions like this: read, write, execute. So I give all the permissions to current user, myself. Then I give read, write, execute to group, means the group which I belong to. So development group. So dev1 and dev2 belong to this group. So dev1 and dev2 have read, write, execute permission. Others, I only give read permission. I'll not give write and execute. This hyphen indicates that there is no permission for others, right? So this is what we see here. First character is whether it's a directory or it's a file. From second till this, these are the permissions. So in this case, if you see read, write, execute, read, there is no write option. Read, there is no write permission, right? So the first three characters indicates it is for the current user, whoever logs in. And these three indicates for the group which he belongs to. And these three indicates, the last three indicates the permissions for the others. Others means other than the current user and other than the group he belongs to. So all others come under this category. Okay, so let us say I logged in as dev1. So what are the permissions I get? I have all the permissions. I can read the file, write the file, execute the file. If I log in as, let us say, dev2, so I am in which group? I am in group, because dev1 belongs to dev group. So dev2 also belongs to his group. So he will also get read, write, execute permission. Then let us say I logged in as test1. So when I logged in as test1, current user is test1. So what are the permissions he get? He belongs to which group? He belongs to others, right? Because he is not in dev, he is not in dev group, he is not dev1, he is into others group. So what are the permissions he gets? He gets these permissions. What are it? Read, no write, no execute. So there is only read permission. Right? Let us say I logged in as again production one. So which group I belongs to for this file? I belong to others group. Again, I will have only read permission. So this way we can restrict the other users from accessing my files. If I am dev1, I want only myself or my team members to have read, write, execute permission. Other than that, nobody should be able to write it or execute it. They can only see its read only permission. Yes. Okay, so let us try to try this. So how do we change the permissions, right? So by default, let us say there are some permissions and I want to change it. I want to give permission to everybody. I want to give read, write, execute, read, write, execute, and read, write, execute to everybody. So this is like everyone has access to read, write, execute the file. So how do I give this permission to everybody, right? So there is a command called chmod. This is change mode. Then we can give the permissions. So how do we give? We need to give permissions to, let us say, here U indicates current user. U indicates current user. G indicates group. O indicates others. Okay, so G indicates group, O indicates others, right? So we can give permissions. We have three kinds of permission. We have three kinds of groups. What is that? User, current user, group, others. These are the people, and we have read permission, write permission, execute permission. So let us say I logged into a machine and there is a file called file1 and I want to give permission to everybody. How do I give? Chmod U plus. Plus is giving the permission. So I'll give read, write, execute, comma, then G plus read, write, execute. I'm giving all the permissions to group as well, comma, then O plus read, write, execute. I'm giving permission to all. So this is the command. If I execute this, it grants all the permissions to everybody. So this is the command we have to execute on the console, on the shell, right? What is the command? Chmod U plus RWX, G plus RWX, O plus RWX. Plus is for assigning, minus is for deleting the, removing the permission. Or I can simply say UGO plus RWX means then file name. This is also same as the above command. It is also will give permissions to everybody. Okay, so let us try that. So I'll just create a directory. Test 1 2 3. So I'll go to test 1 2 3. Now what is my directory? Test 1 2 3. Let me increase the font. Okay, so I'm inside test/test 1 2 3. Let me create a file called file. So if I do lsf and lrt, so these are the permissions. By default, myself has read write, there is no execute permission, and group has read, no write execute. Others also has only read, no write execute. Now I want to give permission to everybody. So how do I give? Chmod U G O user, group, others, plus read, write, execute, file. Now what happens if I do lsf and lrt? If you see, the color is changed from black to green, indicating that it has execute permission. So if you see here, these are the previous permissions. If you see, these are the new permissions. So read, write, execute, read, write, execute, read, write, execute. So everybody has got all the permissions, right? Let us say I want to give, I don't want to give execute permission to others. They can just read or write, but they should not execute. 0-X. What happens now? If you see, this is the previous permission and this is the new permission. This hyphen, this X is replaced with hyphen, indicating that there is no execute permission for others, right? Let us say again, I want to give execute permission for others. O plus X. Again, this will change to X. So like this, we can give different permissions to different people, right? Let us say again, I want to have all the permissions to myself. I don't want to give any permission to my team members. I don't want to give my write or execute permission to my team members or group or others. So how do I do? Chmod. Okay, then I want to remove G hyphen. Hyphen is to remove WX and the file. Now what will happen? So here if you see, write and execute permissions are removed for the group. In the same way, I want to remove for others as well. Now what is the permission? only current user has read, write, execute permission. All others, the group which he belongs to and the others group, they only have read permission. The first three characters indicates for the current user, next three character indicates for the group, next three characters indicates for others, right? Like this, we can change the permissions based on the requirement. So we can restrict people from accessing the file, okay? Now, let us say, so this is one kind of syntax. What is that? Using user, group, others, read, write, permission, giving plus is for assigning, minus is for deleting the, removing the permissions. Now, let us say, there is another syntax as well, right? That is using numbers. Instead of typing all this, we can simply give based on the numbers. So what is that? Again, here we have user, group, and others, but we have some numbers for permissions. So read indicates 4, write indicates 2, execute indicates 1. So if I want to give permissions to everybody, chmod, instead of ugo plus rwx, what I can give is 777 and file. This 7 indicates read plus write plus execute. 4 plus 2 plus 1 is 7. So if I give 777, everybody will get every permission. So what are the permissions we get? Read, write, execute. Read, write, execute. Read, write, execute. And let us say I give chmod 755 file. So it will be 7 means R plus W plus X, 4 plus 2 plus 1. So again, that is read, write, execute. And 5. 5 means combination of which two permissions? Read plus execute. So execute. No write permission. Right? Again, read plus execute, no write permission. Right? Or let us say if I give chmod 7005. So what will be my permissions? Read, write, execute, because 7. 0 indicates that no permissions for group or others. Right? So let us try this. I have one file. So there are some permissions. Now I want to give permission to everybody. What is the command? 777 file. So if I do again lsfnlrt, I will have all the permissions. Right? In the same way, let us say I want to give 744. What will be the permissions if I do lsfnlrt? 7 is read, write, execute. 4 is what? As per this, 4 is which permission? Read, right? So if I do like this, only current user will have all the permissions. Group will have only read permission. Others also will have the read permission, right? So like this, we can change the permissions based on the requirement in two syntaxes. One is using UGO RWX, other is simply using the numbers. So we basically use this mostly because this is easy to use, right? So you just have to give the number based on the permission, and then you can just execute this command that will change the permissions based on the requirement. Is this clear? Chmod is to change mode, change the permissions. There will be different users in a Linux machine. And if I log in, I log in as root. So here I logged in as root. So if I see ID, ID is the command to check what is the current user. What is the current user? Root. UID is root. User ID. GID is group which he belongs to. Right. So if I log in as dev1 and if I type ID, what will be the output? Dev1 as the current user. Dev is the group. So there will be UID, a group ID. ID means there will be some number associated with, let us say some number, let us say 1000 is dev1 number. The group which he belongs to is a dev and its number is also 1000. So there will be some users and the groups which he belongs to. So ID command will give you the user ID and the group ID. Or you can also give who am I. This is also one command. This will also check what is the current user. Or you can also give a command called finger. Okay, I think it's not installed. This will give who all are logged into machine. Okay, and there is also command, let us say you logged into a Linux machine and you want to check what is the version of the Linux, right? So you logged into a machine and is it SLES operating system or Ubuntu or Fedora or CentOS, and what is the version associated with? Is it RHEL 7 or RHEL 6 or RHEL 5 or SLES 12 or Ubuntu 17.10 or 16.04? So there is a file which has this information. Okay, so just say etc star release, cat etc star release. This will basically give the information about the version. If you just say cat etc star release, if you see, this is actually CentOS version 7. Okay, on any operating system, just understand that we'll see what is the star in the coming classes. This is actually a wild character, and so basically there will be multiple files, so where the information of this release will be given. So if we give star, it will open all the files which end with release. Okay, so if you just execute cat slash etc slash star release, it will show Linux flavor, what is the Linux, CentOS or Fedora, and then version associated with it, right? So in this case CentOS 7, or maybe if I log into Red Hat, or let us say I log into Ubuntu, it will show Ubuntu 14.04 or 16.10 or 17, like that there will be versions. So if you just want to check what is the version you're currently working on, you can just say cat etc star release. Okay. So when we let us say there is a remote Linux machine and I want to log in from here, so what are the commands we have to use and what is the tool we need to use? So yeah, we use putty tool to log into a remote machine from Windows laptop, right? So we have to download putty and give the username and then give IP and then give password. So you just give your user host name or the IP address in the box, and then you select telnet or SSH, and then it gives you the prompt for entering username. And then we enter username and the password, we'll be inside the machine if we give the correct password, right? So we use two protocols, one is telnet, the other is SSH. So these are two protocols basically for logging into a machine, right? So this basically listens on a port called 23, and this listens on a port called 22. So on the server, which is in the, so let us assume there is a box. This is my Linux server. This is the hardware. On top of that, there are multiple people trying to log into the machine. Okay, just assume he is the current user and he has a laptop. He is actually working on this machine, remote machine from here, right? So there can be multiple people working on the same machine, right? So how does everyone logs into this machine? Again, using either putty or git bash or terminal, there are different tools to log into server, right? So this is a server and these are the different people. So he is, let us say, some user dev1 and test1, and he again enters his username and the password, and this machine has one IP, right? So that will be some number, something like 9.10.10.10. Then it has a username as well. It has a host name as well. Host name is the name of the machine. And then when he enters from here, he'll log into this machine. Again, when he enters from here, log into this machine. These are remote users who are working on a Linux machine, right? So on this machine, has a huge RAM. This has huge processing capacity. This has storage attached. and everything, cables are connected. So this is in a big data center, right? So this machine is in a big data center. So this has IP associated with, this has host name associated with. When people try to log in, they log into this machine, right? So here, if people want to log into this machine, already there should be a packages related to Telnet and SSH should be installed, right? And the process or daemon should be running. So if it is Telnet or SSH, right? So if people want to log into this machine, let us say there is a Linux administrator, he has to configure Telnet and SSH and he has to give permissions to these people to access this machine, right? So these are called actually protocols, but there will be a daemon associated with. What is a daemon? What is a process? What is a program? Right? So let us say we have just written a Java program or C program or C++ program, right? So we execute that on a Linux machine. So how do we execute? How do we compile? So depending on the programming language, we just compile. Let us say on a Linux machine, you have written a hello world.java program. So what will be there inside the program? It will be something like system.print.ln equal to hello world, right? Then once we have written this program, we need to compile it. We have to compile using Java C, hello world.java. So what happens if we compile? This will actually provide, it will generate a binary called hello world.class, right? Then this is compilation, then we execute using Java hello world. So this will provide a output called hello world because we just say to print hello world using Java. So this just a sample example, right? So in the same way, if you go to a real-time project, instead of hello world, there will be thousands of lines of code which will be executed when we say Java hello world, right? So let us say this program is taking 2 hours to execute. Right? So when we start a program, it actually starts a process, right? So program under execution is called a process. Right? You started the program, you started executing the program. That program is printing something, it is executing something, it is creating some files, it is removing some files. They have some features associated with that program. So people will be able to log into that program or some website is running. So actually, when a program is running on a Linux machine, internally, there is a process associated with it. What is that? Process is nothing but the program under execution. How do we see the process? PS is a command to list out the process, right? If you just say, just clear the screen, and PS-EF will give list of all the process running on the Linux machine. PS-EF will list out the process running on the machine, right? And let us say, so this process here, SSH or Telnet are two programs which are already running on the machine. So they will be running 24/7, 365 days, right? So then only we will be able to log into the Linux machine. So this will actually not run in the terminal in the foreground. They will run in the background. So process running in the background is called a daemon. We'll see what all these in the coming classes, but just for understanding, so SSH, Telnet are two protocols to log into a machine. So if you're not able to log into a machine using SSH or Telnet, there might be a network issue or there might be some problem with respect to Telnet or SSH. Maybe the process is not running, maybe the process is not listening on the port, maybe there is some problem with the daemon, there might be some problem with the configuration file. So these are the things which comes up if you want to debug, right? So the SSH listens on the port 22, Telnet listens on the port 23. So what is the difference? Why SSH is preferred? Because, so when you, let us say you are working on this machine, right? So this is in Bangalore lab and you are working from Hyderabad, and you have given your username and password. So this all are connected over, let us say, wires, right? So this is a wire which is cable connected to the Bangalore lab, and you have given your username and the password. Let us say you have given something like root 123, and since if you use telnet, it is not encrypted, so anybody can hack your password. Basically, we can see what is the password which you are typing, which goes through this cable. So it is not secured. Whereas SSH, when you send a password, it will not go directly, but it will go in encrypted fashion, so that nobody can hack it. So that's the only difference between the telnet and SSH. Telnet, if you use telnet and the machine name, it will be prompted to give username and the password. And if you enter the password, that password can be hacked easily by anybody. But if you use SSH, the password which you enter will be encrypted and sent. So that's the reason why it's always preferable to use SSH. Okay. What is SSH and what is telnet? They are the protocols to log into a machine. So how do we log into a machine? Using tools like PuTTY. And what are the selections we have to do? We have to enter either your host name or the IP address, and then we have to give username and the password. And then we have to select either it is telnet or SSH. And when you enter the proper password, we'll log into the Linux machine. So there will be shell open where we can type the commands and execute and get the jobs done, right? So what are the other commands we have? Is this clear so far? So let us see. So I said I have asked to install three tools, right? Vagrant, then Oracle VirtualBox, Git, right? So what they do, and also ask it to enable the virtualization. So this is for you to practice the lab, practice the Linux command, practice the shell scripting, practice Chef, Puppet, Ansible, everything you can do in your laptop itself, right? So how do we do that? So we have to basically download Vagrant, Oracle VirtualBox, and Git. So this Git is like a terminal, something like PuTTY. So this is easy to use. That's why I've asked you to download Git. Once you download Git, and even in your start button, if you just say Git bash, it will open this kind of Git bash application. And if you just open, it will open a terminal like this, right? Then you can go to one specific directory, right? So what are the steps? First, open Git bash. It will open a terminal. Then once you have installed all these things, you have Git bash. Now what is Oracle VirtualBox? This is a kind of hypervisor, right? So basically what we want to do is we want to virtualize our environment, Windows environment, then create a virtual machine on top of that. So basically on top of Windows, we are creating a Linux virtual machine, right? So generally, how do you create a Linux machine? I'll come to that. What is Vagrant? How do you create a virtual machine, right? So we have installed Oracle VirtualBox, and there will be option to create a VM, right? Then generally we create a VM, then we give something like CPU, RAM, hard disk size and all. Once we have given a VM will be created, but we have to install the VM. How do we install the VM? We have to download something called ISO. How do we install a Windows machine? If you want to install a Windows laptop, you have to get a CD, or you have to get a USB with a bootable OS. Then we'll go through some steps. It will ask some steps like your time zone, username, password, etc., etc. If you have everything installed, maybe in half an hour or 1 hour, you get the machine ready. In the same way, Linux also we install, but we use something called ISO. Let us say it is something like Red Hat 7SP1 x86_64. This is the hardware type .iso. So this is the installation media for Linux. You can simply download this from the net and install Red Hat. operating system on the VM. So this is Oracle VM VirtualBox. Once you installed, you'll get this kind of menu. Okay, so these are actually my VMs, virtual machines. So what does this do? This is actually a virtualization enabler, or you can say hypervisor, which is sitting on top of the Windows laptop that will virtualize our environment, and it will give a way for us to run multiple virtual machines on top of the Windows laptop, right? So now we have to go through all these things. What is it? We have to install Oracle VirtualBox, create a VM and give it a name, and then select what is your Linux operating system version and all these things. If you give, then it creates a template. Then on that, again, we have to install. So this is like a tedious process, right? So installing a OS. So they have come up with a tool called Vagrant that automates everything. Now, if you have Vagrant installed on your machine, you don't have to do anything. It will do everything for us, right? So how does it do? So basically, it has something called pre-installed images. Everything is done. You just have to download the image and get the VM up in 3 steps, right? We'll go to what is Vagrant in detail in the coming classes, but just for practice, now I'll give you 3 steps which you have to do. Okay, just install all 3 tools. Open Git Bash. Okay, then create some directory, something like mkdir vagrant1, and go to the directory cd vagrant1. Then third step is just say vagrant init. This will create something called a vagrant file, right? So somewhere we have to tell what is the operating system you want. You want Red Hat, or you want Ubuntu, or you want Fedora. That we tell in Vagrant file. Then modify Vagrant file to specify OS related information, right? So I'll just open Git Bash. Now create a directory, let us say Vagrant 1 2 3. Then okay, already there. So create, don't give slash, it will try to create in the root directory. Give just mkdir, just cd, and give mkdir vagrant123. This is your current directory, right? What are the steps? Open Git Bash, and then mkdir vagrant1, cd vagrant1, and say vagrant init. 123 or 1, anything is fine. Then pwd is, it will create a directory inside my home directory. So this is in Windows, this is my home directory, and vagrant123 I created. Now just say vagrant init. This will create a file called vagrant file in the local machine, right? Now just open this file using vi command. We opened the Git Bash, we created a directory, we changed the directory, then we executed a command called vagrant init. That will create a vagrant file. This vagrant file we have to modify. How do we modify? We can open using Notepad++ and modify if you're not comfortable with VI, because we have not covered VI. That's fine, but just open this vagrant file. And so there is something called config.vm.box equal to base, right? So this will change it to, what is that, config.vm.box is equal to, there is base, right? So that we'll remove that base and we'll say Ubuntu Xenial 64. What is Xenial 64? So every Ubuntu version will have a name. This Xenial 64 is a version associated with 16.04. So 16.04 operating system they call Xenial. 17.10 they call with some other name. Precise, there are different names for the operating system. So when we say Xenial, it will actually download 16.04. So I'll just modify this, delete this. Or if you're not comfortable, we can simply do using Notepad++ also. So what is the directory I need to go? C users, your home directory. So what is the directory I created? Vagrant123. So go to Vagrant123 and just try to edit this file with Notepad++. And there is base, so remove this and say Ubuntu Xenion 64 and save. Control S and that's all. Then just go here and say Vagrant up. What will happen is you are actually getting a VM ready. You're actually not installing, but someone has already installed for you and they have put their image in the cloud. So there is a Vagrant cloud. And then from there, when we say Vagrant up, it will download the image to your local machine, your Windows machine, and it will boot the VM up with the Ubuntu image which we downloaded, right? Vagrant is something like an application which is installed on, we'll see what is Vagrant in depth, just because why I'm trying to do this is initially so that we can just practice the basic commands, right? So try this, we have Vagrant class, what is Vagrant, how it is pulling the images, where are the images, how to search, all these things we'll see. But for now, just do this blindly, just to get the VM environment ready. So what is the use case of Vagrant, why Vagrant is developed is, basically let us say I'm a developer and I have application ready and I have given a bug fix and that is failing in the production because I tested my in Ubuntu and it is failing in Red Hat operating system. In production there are multiple machines, it is working in Ubuntu but it is failing on Red Hat. What is the problem? Because as a developer I did not test on Red Hat, I tested on Ubuntu. So to get the environment again I have to run to a tester and ask for a Ubuntu machine and then try on it. So to avoid all these things, what we can do is instead of going to someone, we can develop environment locally on my laptop itself. I can have Red Hat operating system, I can have Ubuntu operating system, Fedora, all these things I can develop locally. How is that? Using tools like Vagrant, Oracle VirtualBox, Git. What is Git? Git is actually a version control tool, but it also provides a nice graphical user interface. That's the reason why I'm asking to install Git. Okay, using Git bash we can type the commands. So after installing all these things and after enabling the virtualization, just open Git bash, it'll open a terminal, create a directory, go to the directory and say Vagrant init. This will create a Vagrant file. Why this is required? Because we have to tell something like install this VM, I want Ubuntu, I want Red Hat, I want Fedora. That we specify here. We can also specify some advanced things like I want this IP, I want this much RAM, I want this much CPU, but that and all we'll see later. But this will create a development environment, a lab inside your laptop itself. So try this and we'll see if there are any issues tomorrow. Okay. Yes, Git bash is something like a terminal where you execute the commands. So actually when you say Vagrant up, what happens is Vagrant will read this file, which is my Vagrant file, and it understands that user has asked to install Ubuntu Xenial 64. So it will go to Vagrant cloud, it will download the image and Oracle VirtualBox will create a VM and it will boot with that particular VM. So once this is ready, you will have a VM up and running on your Windows laptop. Then if you say Vagrant SSH, you'll log into the machine, right? Then you can execute the commands. So try this. Don't worry about what is this and how it's done, what is happening internally. That we'll cover in detail when we are covering Vagrant, which is like next topic. Okay, so this is just to practice the basic commands on your laptop itself.